Clarion Books and Harper Audio present My Not-So-Great French Escape by Cliff Burke, performed by Henri Lubatti. For my students, especially for those who feel like they do not belong. There is nothing better than the encouragement of a good friend. Jean-Jacques Rousseau. 1.
Smile,
my mom urged. I was standing in front of a pulled-down white screen in the corner of a CVS as a harried cashier struggled with an old digital camera.
He's actually not allowed to smile, the cashier corrected.
I let my face fall into a grimace.
You also can't frown, the cashier said. You just have to look normal.
I'm trying to look normal, I said, doing my best to keep my face absolutely blank. The cashier shrugged.
It's your passport picture.
He clicked the silver button and passed the camera over for Mom's inspection. She glanced disapprovingly and asked, Would you mind taking another?
This isn't a photo shoot, the cashier said.
I know, I'm sorry, just one more.
Fine, last one.
He readjusted the focus on my face.
A little smile,
Mom begged.
But don't smile, the cashier said.
I tried to smile without smiling while also looking normal. In the small picture printed and handed to me, I looked like I was angrily holding in a yawn. We left the store and I trudged to the passenger side of Mom's car. For the past 2 years, the door wouldn't budge unless popped open from the inside. As I waited for her to open it, I inspected my passport photo again, hoping it might look different in the sunlight. It didn't.
That wasn't so bad, was it?
Mom said once I slid into my seat.
I look like I'm sick.
I think you look handsome, maybe a little confused, but still handsome. Besides, your passport won't last forever.
How long does it last?
10 years. I gulped as I envisioned still carrying this awful picture around at 22.
Can we maybe go to another CVS?
I asked. No, she plucked the picture from my hands and examined it again.
It really isn't so bad.
She handed it back to me, and I turned it face down on my lap.
You know, I didn't have my first passport until I was 25, she said.
I know, Mom. She'd been repeating this tidbit for the past 4 weeks. And I didn't go to France until I was 32. I know.
Why do you get so upset when I try to share the details of my life?
Because you share the same details over and over.
We can't all live such fascinating lives.
You're just lucky Serena still likes me. I also knew I was lucky. Serena was Mom's best friend from college, and she had become extremely rich by creating an app that reminded other rich people to drink water. They used to forget, apparently, but are now very well hydrated, and Serena is very well paid. So well paid that for the past year she's sponsored my education at the St. Dominic de Guzman School for Sterling Scholars in Menlo Park, California.
And that Wilder still likes you, Mom said. I don't know about that, I said.
He asked you to come with him, didn't he? He could have asked anyone.
I'm sure you had nothing to do with that.
Rylan, I didn't say anything about him bringing you. When was the last time I even saw him?
And you didn't mention anything to Serena?
A suggestion here or there, maybe, but certainly not what you're implying.
Sure, I said.
Besides, I thought you guys made up.
I guess, but that doesn't mean there aren't, what's the word,
repercussions.
One of which is that he's trying to make it up to you by inviting you to France.
She danced around in her seat in an imitation of a mime or a French person or something.
What are you doing? This is the French yé yé girl dance, she said. You didn't think your mom knew about yé yé.
I have no idea what that means, so no, it's not surprising.
Add it to your list.
How many things do I have to read before I leave? I thought the point was to discover the culture there.
Yes, but you don't want to be uncultured beforehand. The French don't take kindly to that. From what I've read, they don't take kindly to most things.
That's not true. They love things that are French.
I pulled out my phone and added yé yé to my French things mom says I need to know notes document, below Jean-Luc Godard and coq au vin.
What's coq à vin again? I asked.
Coq au vin, she enunciated. Chicken in wine sauce. You'll probably have that at the farm.
You think he's going to give us wine?
Wine sauce. You wouldn't get drunk from it unless you ate the entire chicken.
Why would I eat an entire chicken?
You're a growing boy, she said.
I wouldn't be surprised if he served wine, too.
Really? I said excitedly. It's a French custom, but just a few sips, hopefully.
Or a few glasses.
He wouldn't do that. Right?
How would I know? Pierre's the first person on the list, she said. Please tell me you've read at least a little about him.
Pierre de Beaulieu was the owner of the French farm where Wilder and I would be staying and working for the next month, and I'd read more than a little about him. I knew that his great-great-uncle was a famous general who protected Napoleon from an attempted assassination, that as a reward for taking a bullet in his cheek, this uncle was gifted a chateau in northern France, that after a century of neglect, Pierre moved back to the chateau and began the process of converting it into a fully organic farm, and that when he grew tired of paying people, he started inviting students to work for free through a program called SCOF, Students Communing on French Farms. But while there were many glowing reviews of the SCOF program online, there weren't any mentions of Pierre's farm, his personality, or whether or not he served wine with dinner.
2. Against my wishes, we went directly from CVS to Wilder's house. He used to live in Belmont, 5 minutes away from us, but his house was now a 25-minute drive into the manicured greens and gated complexes of Atherton.
Bienvenue, Serena said as she opened their thick front door. Merci, Mom said with a giggle.
They greeted each other French style, gently touching cheeks while puckering their lips and making a kissing sound.
Come here, Rylan, Serena said, leaning down slightly.
You must practice faire la bise. She pressed her right cheek to mine and made a kissing sound while I tried to do the same. But mine sounded more like a mouth fart, and Serena recoiled.
Wilder's in his room, she said flatly.
I stepped past her and waved to Wilder's dad, who was working on his laptop at the kitchen table.
Though he spoke within a limited range of expressions, he was always nice to me. I was expecting a, "There he is," but was surprised with a, "There's our guy." He followed that up with, "Doing good?" "Yep." "Well, all right." I knew that was the end of our conversation, so I walked up the stairs, past the painted portrait of Wilder, where he's posed like an angel, and stopped at his bedroom door. I considered knocking, but instead swung it open and said, "What up?" in a robot voice. He was sprawled on his bed, rapidly texting, and he barely looked up. "One second," he mumbled. I immediately felt foolish. I rolled out his desk chair and spun in slow circles, waiting for Wilder's attention. He continued tapping his thumbs without looking at me. I pulled out my phone and texted him, "Hey, man." He made an irritated sound as my text flashed on his phone. "This is important," he said. "Can I use your computer then?" I asked. "No." I turned anyway and tried to type in his old password, but it didn't work. I sighed and inspected the corkboard of pictures that hung next to his desk, surprised to find one picture of us remaining in the far left corner. It was from the first day of kindergarten, when we were still best friends. We had first met as toddlers, when our moms plopped us next to each other and asked that we share toys. He had better toys than I did, and wasn't very good at sharing. But over time, when I learned that crying and shouting, "He won't share!" isn't the best way to make friends, we formed a bond. By the time we entered kindergarten and could decide who to sit next to, we chose each other. The teacher tried to encourage us to make new friends and even forbade us from sitting together, but her plan didn't work. We sat a space apart, ducked our heads behind the person between us, and kept on talking until our teacher changed her policy. This continued until fifth grade, when Serena started making money and pulled Wilder out of public school. For the first few months, we still spent weekends together, but soon he was invited to sleepovers at mansions and parties at backyard pools. I became self-conscious whenever he came to my apartment and embarrassed when we climbed into our apartment complex's small shared pool, knowing that splashing around a 20-foot circle must be disappointing after swimming laps in luxury. We still hung out on special occasions, always at Wilder's house, but by the end of the school year, we were more like cousins than best friends, which is why I was so surprised when Mom told me that starting in sixth grade, I'd be going to the same private middle school as Wilder. I protested, but Mom wouldn't budge. "It would be fine," she said. "I would have Wilder," she said. "He still was my best friend. We had just spent a little time apart." But she was wrong. At the St. Dominic de Guzman School for Sterling Scholars, every student is given their own laptop and Google account. While everyone appears sterling on the surface, their true personalities are expressed in hundreds of privately shared docs and slides. There, everyone competes to find the most offensive memes and savagely bullies one another. At the beginning of the year, I was shared on some of the meme slides and praised for my contributions. I thought I was doing fairly well. In class, I was sought out as a partner for collaborative projects. I knew I was doing more than my fair share of the work, but I didn't let that fact bring me down. My teachers, in their page-long essays that served as grades, described me as curious and engaged, and only needing to grow in my self-advocacy skills. But after the first month or so, I felt a certain distance from everyone. Most of them had known each other since pre-K, and their tangled history with one another, their sense of being real Sterling scholars who grew up together, created a barrier that was nearly impenetrable. Wilder had fit in because his greatest skill was molding himself to be liked by whomever was directly in front of him. He was not fully accepted, but he was certainly liked. The few times I was invited to a party outside of school, it was clearly due to respect for him, not because anyone really wanted me hanging around. This was just a general feeling until 2 months ago, when Wilder accidentally shared a slideshow titled Rylan. There were pictures of crumbling shacks and bombs.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.